Good afternoon. Welcome to Comstock Concert Hall on this stunning spring day. Thank you for not going out and sunbathing, but for joining us for this event. Most of you know me, but I am Mark Satterwhite, the director of the Grawemeyer Award for Music Composition. It is my distinct pleasure today to introduce our 2007 winner, Mr. Sebastian Currier. I won't belabor the biographical information. It's on your little program. There's also a card out there that has more detailed information you can pick up on the way out. I will just say what a lovely time we've been having with Sebastian this week. He's been incredibly gracious, has worked with our private composition students, has had social meals with all kinds of people. It's very hard to be on all the time, but he has been more than up to the task and has, I think, been a real asset to our students, to the community members that have met him, and I'll just leave it at that. Please join me in welcoming Sebastian Currier.
Thanks very much. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I've been having a great time here. It's been a lot of fun. I'm going to read just because it's sort of more efficient, I think, to say what I want to say. So, good afternoon. It's a great pleasure to be here and have the opportunity to talk to you about my piece, Static. Being a composer, it should not surprise you that I find merit in the saying, music takes over where words leave off. Accordingly, I would like to play you my piece as well as comment on it, and thought the best way for present purposes would be to intermingle the six movements of my piece with my commentary. That way I can both direct you to elements I'd like you to listen to and also refer to aspects that you've just heard a moment before. Static is scored for flute, clarinet, violin, cello, and piano, and was commissioned by Music from Copeland House, who gave the premiere in 2005 at the Willa Theater in New York. It's an instrumentation, in its instrumentation and its partitioning into six discrete but interrelated movements, it connects to a long tradition of instrumental chamber music. Instead of the more traditional terms like allegro and adagio and so forth, the movements of Static are remote, ethereal, bipolar, resonant, charged, and floating. I mention this connection to classical chamber forms for two reasons. First, because besides the work of Boulez, which received the award in 2001, Static is the only chamber work to receive a Grawemeyer. And second, because, as I will discuss in more detail later, I feel a deep affinity and connection to music of the past, which informs in one way or another all of my music. Although I cannot really comment on why in the past Grawemeyer judges have tended to favor larger forces or genres, such as orchestra and opera, I can use this opportunity to celebrate the importance of chamber music in music in general. Indeed, were we to survey some of the most lasting and influential works of the 20th century, we'd find that chamber works loom large. Schoenberg's Pierre Lunaire, Bartok's string quartets, Messiaen's quartet for the end of time, Ligeti's horn trio, just to name a few prominent examples. So, quite apart from the obviously self-serving fact that it's been a great opportunity for me, at this present moment, I would suggest in general applaud the representation of chamber music amongst other genres for the Grawemeyer, because I think it's such an important part of 20th century and 21st century music making. I've always been drawn to chamber music, both because of its intimacy and because of the subtlety and flexibility in performance. It offers a perfect balance between individual voice on the one hand and communal effort on the other. When one hears a piano trio, for example, one effortlessly separates out the violinist sound from the cellist and the pianist, while at the same time taking in the totality of their union together. As a composer, I find few things more thrilling and gratifying than the process of working with musicians. And over the years, I've found chamber music to allow for more engaging interaction and nuanced interpretation. And this was certainly true of my work with the players of Music from Copeland House. A few days after the premiere of Static, they also recorded the piece. It is this performance that I'll be playing you this afternoon. So let me begin by playing the first movement, which, as I mentioned, is marked remote. Before I play the whole movement, though, let me just play you the very beginning. Mm-hmm. a single chord that starts softly, swells in amplitude, and then disappears into silence. Both the color of the chord and its falling off into nothingness create an aura that is bleak and remote. Its wave-like envelope and the specific arrangement of pitches recur throughout this movement and the piece as a whole. In this way, you might think of the chord as a theme. The notes of the chord are C, E, B, three-quarter tones flat, D flat, E flat, and A flat. Even if you are not so familiar with musical notation, the B three-quarter tone flat probably stands out. It is only in recent music pieces of mine that I've been exploring microtones, and for the very reason that static is not generally saturated with them, that the quality of this chord stands out. I might add parenthetically that the use of microtones has in general been gaining prominence in American music, I think in part because of the intersection of two different influences, greater interest in world music and the influence of the spectral music from Europe. As the first movement unfolds, you will hear this chord motive reiterated numerous times, often with subtly changing coloration. Notice the last few occurrences. Here, though the wave-like envelope remains, the chord quality is different, more peaceful, expressive. The feeling of movement from the first chord to the last is reflected in the large-scale structure of static, repeated over a much greater time span. Now let me play you the first movement, Remote.
probably notice a number of things I didn't mention. One is the role of the piano. When you strike a note on the piano, its envelope is such that its loudest point is at its initiation of the note, and there's a gradual decay from that point on. Thus, the piano could not take part in wave-like chords and is absent during a significant portion of the movement. It enters twice, both times with a gently repeating note. Each of these passages starts softly, swells up, and subsides, repeating the gesture, if not the substance, of the opening chord. The second of these also leads to the one reiteration of the chord that does include the piano, and forms the climactic moment of the movement. At this point, you might have noticed that as you heard the sound of the chord, you also heard various additional, or possibly even extraneous sounds, trills and repeated bass note in the piano, tremolos. I will come back to that in a moment and just wanted to call it to your attention. But first, I want to return to what I mentioned earlier about my strong connection to music of the past and how it has manifested much of my music. I grew up within a musical family. My mother and brother are composers, and my father was a violinist. After early on trying unsuccessfully to make string players out of my brother and I, my parents left us to our own devices, whereupon we soon got involved in rock music. I played guitar, my brother keyboards, and my neighborhood friends made up the rest of the various bands that we played in. We wrote our own songs. With our synthesizers, Gibson guitars, and Marshall amps stacked up in our basement, we drove our parents and neighbors to despair. We listened constantly to Black Sabbath, Emerson, Lake & Palmer, Led Zeppelin, Genesis, Yes, and all sorts of other stuff. We were totally obsessed. As time went on, something happened though. My parents, both classically trained, had a good sized record collection of classical music. At a certain point, my brother and I started listening to various records from it, probably to a large extent at random. As much as I breathed and dreamt rock music, putting on these recordings, I remember the feeling of a new world opening up. This music, Beethoven, Bach, Bartok, Shostakovich, Brahms, Chopin, Schubert, Schumann, seemed to have such breadth of emotion and expression, such a variety in sound. It felt like in this music, there was nothing you couldn't express. A rock song, as fantastic as it was, began and it ended. These pieces I started listening to, on the other hand, seemed to take you through a vast internal world on a journey that seemed to embrace any emotion you could ever feel. I think in various ways, I've been trying to recreate these experiences. The feeling of music is mind travel in all the music I've written. One manifestation in static is the multi-movement format. Why have a piece of music divided into movements? In music of the past, it's something so ubiquitous and common, we can forget to ask the question. I'm sure a musicologist could give a more historically based answer, but as a listener and composer, I would say simply that it formalizes a variety of emotional states or musical characters types within a single movement. Or in other terms, it assures musical breadth. Each movement is designed to scope out different musical territory. Which brings me to the second movement, ethereal. I think of it as somehow occupying the musical terrain of a minuet or scherzo, but transformed into something more ephemeral or ghostly. This transformation is created in large part through the modes of articulation the instruments employ. The flute, and sometimes the clarinet, uses key clicks, which creates a percussive effect with only traces of the pitch coming through. The string plays collegno. In the violin part, this is paired with a bouncing bow effect, where the player draws the bow closer and farther from the bridge as it ricochets, so it sort of comes in closer, moves out farther like that, which creates a subtle shimmering of overtones over the basic pitch. Let me play you this movement now. This is ethereal. Thank you. You may have noticed, in the middle of the movement, where the piano is playing ethereal passage work, the rest of the instruments are playing chords with a slow wave-like envelope. As I mentioned before, this figure is interwoven throughout the piece. You also maybe noticed, though it occurred very briefly, a sound that will play a greater and greater role in the world of static. Just at the end of the movement, the cello played a trill between two natural harmonics. This brings me to the title of the piece. The word static, for me, has two divergent or even opposing meanings. One, something that is unchanging and a state of equilibrium. The other, something active and chaotic, some form of interference with a basic signal, like the erratic white noise of radio static. Although it is not really an antithetical word, it resembles this interesting class of linguistic utterance. Take, for example, the word bound. On the one hand, we say, I was bound for New York, while on the other hand, we say, I was bound to the chair. One describes movement, the other the lack of movement. Or take the word refrain. We say, please refrain from doing that. But we also say, the song's refrain repeated endlessly. In a somewhat different context, Freud was interested in antithetical words. He wrote a paper, The Antithetical Meaning of Primal Words. It followed from some of the work of a German linguist named Karl Abel. Abel, noting that some basic Latin words could mean opposite things, theorized that words in a more primitive state may have contained their opposites, which were gradually teased apart through the application of rational thought. He said, when learning to think about force, we have to separate it from weakness. To conceive of darkness, we must isolate it from light. Freud related this to some of his ideas about dreams, where an image or a desire can mean both one thing and its opposite. In static, these two divergent meanings are alluded to in various ways. The slow, distant, wave-like chords that you've heard in the first movement suggest an interior landscape that is inert and unchanging. There is in the first movement, excepting a few moments, a general feeling of stasis, of lack of movement, as we hear the chord I mentioned earlier reiterated again and again with only subtle alterations. Representation of the other static is at this point mostly subliminal, presented obliquely and fleetingly. In general, this other static takes two forms. The first, soft, slightly random, and noise-like sounds. The second, loud, quite intense, and chaotic music built up of multiple layers of material. One of the most characteristic manifestations of the former, which is the soft form, is where string trills are played in harmonics, paired with changing in bow pressure and placement, which causes various harmonics to stand out in a constantly changing and random fashion. You have heard a little of this sound where I pointed out the cello trill between two harmonics. These sounds become more and more prevalent as the piece continues. As to the more chaotic sounds, we will encounter them in the next movement. In this movement, marked bipolar, the two divergent meanings of static, both stasis and chaotic activity, are presented in the most stratified and contrasting fashion. We hear a soft, very long-held chord punctuated by a mournful sigh in the violin, which is also, you'll probably note, is somewhat like the shape of the original chord. This is interrupted by a frenzied, chaotic, and dissonant passage of ensemble counterpoint, which once spinning itself out, ends as abruptly as it began, leaving once again the static, the sustained static chord, this time though, with a violin sighs absent, and a new, peaceful, singing line in the clarinet. Notice also the harmonic trills that begin and end the movement. Let's listen to the third movement, bipolar. displays in the most blatant fashion the almost antithetical meanings of the word static. Its formal makeup also has another source. Music is by its nature multidimensional and lends itself to more than one simultaneous narrative. This other source is a Stephen Crane poem I set to music in a piece I wrote many, many years ago called Human All Too Human. Here's the poem, it's very short. I was in the darkness. I could not see my words, nor the wishes of my heart. Then suddenly there was a great light, let me into the darkness again. I very much like the inversion of the more conventional symbolism of light and dark. Here, one's inner darkness exposed in the glaring light. In my vocal setting, the form is very similar to what you heard in Bipolar. It starts very softly, but as a singer intones, then suddenly there was a great light. The music becomes chaotic and discordant. But as she sings, let me into the darkness, the music returns once again to the peacefulness of the beginning. And she sings once again the opening, but as a vocal ease. It feels different. This time there's a sense of luxuriance in the self-protective darkness. Bipolar follows this too with the placement of the violin size with the cantabile clarinet line. One might reasonably ask, two divergent meanings of static, fine. But why do that? I respond to that question in more general terms. I have always been drawn to the combining of opposite forces, both juxtaposing them, as you just heard in Bipolar, but also in tracing the continuum that leads from one to another. Many of my pieces involve this kind of procedure in one way or another, sometimes more explicitly, as in Verge, a chamber piece for violoncello and piano, where there are movements like almost too fast, almost too slow, or almost too light, almost too dark. Or in a piece like Vocalissimus, a song cycle that sets the same Wallace Stevens poem 18 times, each time from a different perspective, where the settings are named things like optimist, pessimist, introvert, extrovert, and these are intentionally juxtaposed next to each other. In other pieces, it is more implicit, as in the pairing of 18th century cadences with more modern tonal organizations in microsynth or a piece like Broken Minuets. In a vocal piece like Night Mass, it is built into the text itself. A religious conception of the world, as presented in the ordinary of the Latin Mass, is confronted with a more scientific, rationalist viewpoint of the world. I think the reason for this is that music itself maps onto such concepts with extraordinary ease because, at its core, much of its internal architecture exhibits analogous relationships. Music is made from high and low, loud and soft, fast and slow, and all the gradients in between. A movement like Bipolar clearly employs such basic musical relationships as fast, slow, soft, loud, to represent the sharply contrasting interpretations of static. The following movement, marked resonant, operates differently. Here, the two types of static, rather than alternate with each other, are combined in a contrapuntal fabric, such that they are always coexisting with one another. First the violin, then the other strings and winds, present an extended, slowly unfolding, lyrical, and ultimately calm melody throughout much of the movement. Against this, the piano plays rather random-sounding, rhythmically unpredictable figures. Let's listen to the fourth movement, resonant. Thank you.
Thank you.
Earlier, I mentioned that the multi-movement format of my piece showed vestiges of 18th century sonata cycle. And if, in some elliptical way, the second movement took on aspects of a minuet, then the movement we just heard clearly functions as the slow movement lying at the heart of the piece. I think of the next movement, Charged, as the turning point in the overall structure of static. It both creates the most extended section of intensity and ushers in the end of the piece. There are several aspects I'd like to point out before we listen. First is its instrumentation. In this, and only this movement, piccolo is substituted for flute, and bass clarinet is substituted for clarinet. This lends a tonal uniqueness to the movement and also helps to contribute to the feeling of sustained intensity. Also, if you listen carefully, you might discern a connection with the bipolar movement, the third movement. The entire chaotic middle section returns here, but now it is much more integrated with the surrounding material and further intensified by the extended range available with the piccolo and bass clarinet. Let's listen to Charged, the fifth movement.
Thank you.
As the intensity of charge dissipates at its end, it sets the stage for the final movement, floating, which brings static to a close. Eric Kendall, the noted neurobiologist, said, "Without the binding force of memory, experience would be splintered into as many fragments as there are moments in life. Without the mental time travel provided by memory, we would have no awareness of our personal history, no way of remembering the joys that serve as the luminous milestones of our life." Since a piece of music unfolds in time, memory plays an enormously important role. If it were not for memory, a piece of music would be just a string of separate, inconsequential notes. This is true at all time scales, from the motive, to the phrase, to the movement, or to the entire piece. The last movement of static is largely built from memories of the previous movements. Like real memories, they are fragmented and disembodied from their original surroundings. They float by, one by one, some distinct, others vague. Surrounding these fragments is static. Trills to harmonics, ethereal tremolos, whistle tones on the flute, ghostly arpeggiations. In these insubstantial, hushed, and mercurial processes, the two forms of static meet. The whole movement feels suspended and peaceful, while at the same time, it glitters with the effervescent, fleeting sounds of static. Since, as I said before, music takes over where words leave off, let me give music the last say and close my talk with the last movement of static.
Thank you.
Little time. I'd be happy to open up the questions if you have any questions. Maybe we could turn the house lights up a bit too. Thanks. Of any nature whatsoever.
Yes.
Cerebral aspect or the emotional aspect or something like that. Thing of starting, it's a mix of one or the other. Usually I don't have some, an idea of a piece emerges over time, and then once I have that idea, then it starts to channel things in the opposite direction, but at first I'm sort of just like searching in the dark, basically. So, does that answer your question? I think
you're
yes,
thank you.
Yes? On the other hand, I'd also say that there's something about, one of the most interesting things about music is sort of internal, simply designed nature that gives, what makes way for emotion. So, I mean, I think that's the large part, but of course sounds around you can take in, and I've, in a more straightforward way, I've done some pieces recently with a video artist, a piece that's about landfills that uses sounds from garbage trucks and so on. I mean, I sort of channeled that and taken that and made that into a musical thing. So that's a very direct thing of that. But, you know, here I wasn't thinking of it so much, but it could creep in for sure. Anybody else? We're going down the road. Your turn is 7:30. Sorry.
In the same vein of contrast of emotion and rationality, did I hear you say that you had written a piece in which you had contrasted religiosity versus scientific rationality?
Correct. When I say that too, I mean, because it did it through a text, not, you know what I mean, more than through the music. But yes, I wrote a piece, which I was discussing with some of the students 2 days ago, but I was asked to write a mass by this orchestra in New York, and he said I could do whatever I wanted with it. I mean, it didn't have to be exactly a mass. So what I did, I worked with a writer friend of mine, and we basically kept the first two movements, the Kyrie and the Gloria, and the last two movements, the Sanctus and the Agnus Dei, but took out the credo and replaced it with our own text, which was this much more scientific viewpoint of the world, and that I like to think of as sort of replacing the idea of absolute belief with instead sort of wonderment and doubt. So that's sort of how that worked. Anybody else?
Is that piece recorded?
Which piece? Night Mass? No. One day, but it takes time. Particularly for orchestra stuff, I mean, it's a long, it's even with jam music, it's maybe, you know, you write a piece and maybe 5 years later does it get recorded usually. So with orchestra, like double that or triple that or something like that.
You should mention Static, however.
Oh, Static, however, is recorded. It just came out. What you just heard was from a recording of chamber music that Music from Copeland House just released a few weeks ago. And as you mentioned last night, was made to coordinate with the announcement of Grawemeyer. So sort of, it has on the CD cover and everything. So it was really great.
I'm curious to how it was recorded.
How in the process?
Yeah, what was the process?
Yeah. So recorded, we gave the premiere, and so the very next day, we went into the recording studio, which it came out well, but those things are tense. You don't have a lot of time, and I remember we were going on, I think on the charged movement, and it turned out the flutist, Paul Dunkel, who was a really great player, so he had to be at, he plays in the City Opera, and we were way out of town, and he had to leave pretty soon. He was used to like the whole commute thing, so he had it down, he could make it in 70 minutes. But it was like getting really tense, and you know, you're working and we aren't quite done. And finally, we finished, and you know, you never know as a composer, it's hard to know, but a very good producer who eventually edits. Basically what you do is do a lot of takes and then you edit it together. It's not layered like pop music or something like that. You record it and then stitch it together, basically, and she did a great job.
It was done in a digital world?
No, it's recorded analog, but then it's edited digitally, and then, yeah, exactly. Yes, is that a question up there? Yeah, sorry.
I enjoyed the switch to the piccolo and bass clarinet.
Uh-huh.
Can you give us a little bit more explanation on your thoughts, why to do that, and so forth?
Sure, as I say, in part it was really, I think mostly, when you do something like that, it's separated out. As I say, sort of beginning and middle, it divides the beginning and the middle from the end. So that sort of acoustic difference separated that, and just the simple, the increased intensity of it. I don't think I had any other reasons besides that that I can remember. I mean, you could say, well, why didn't I have it more, you know, use them more interchangeably, but I thought that somehow would help to sort of make a clear formal delineation in the instrumentation.
Was your compositional process organic in that you wrote first and then named the movements as a response to what you wrote, or was it the other way around?
Yes, in almost all cases, I wrote and I named the movement. You know, as an answer to your question, I mean, the thing with that is, it's not necessarily one nor the other. Maybe by the last movement, I already knew what I was doing, and you know what I mean, named it first or something, but generally, yes, I would work on something and then think of a title. And even the idea of Static, I think that sort of you know, I was just writing some chamber piece, and that sort of emerged as time went on. And then when it, the funny thing is, when it emerges, then you can sort of, even like a writer might do this with a novel too, then you go back and sort of do things earlier on. So in that sense, it's organic, but not necessarily linear. You know what I mean? I sort of traced it around different ways. Anybody else? Good. Well, it's very nice to be here and talk with all of you. I'm sure I'll see you around. Have a good afternoon.